Happy New Year, and welcome back to the Spartan Journal, your go-to podcast for staying up to date and informed about the ever-evolving world around us. I'm your host, Shadi Khamis, and I'm thrilled to be joined by our executive editor, Alex Kaminski, along with our co-host, Liam Rhattigan. Let's dive into the fifth episode of our series, where we will unravel the dynamics shaping our lives today. Today, we will be evaluating the S&P 500, Tesla owners in turmoil, and finally, disconnecting from the stock market. The date is January 28th, 2024, and you're listening to the Spartan Journal.
Here are this week's market evaluations. The S&P 500 is down 3.19 points and 0.07% this week, while the Dow Jones Industrial Average is up 60.33 points and 0.16%. And finally, the NASDAQ is down 55.14 points and 0.36% this week. The S&P 500 hit a year high this week, a special note to how the markets are making an upswing.
The Russell 2000 is up 17.39 points and 0.89% this week, while MSCI International is down 7.54 points and 1.35% this week. Finally, Barclays is up 0.28 points and 3.76% this week. Here's our stock of the week, brought to you by Yahoo Finance. AppFolio, a real estate software company for vertical markets. AppFolio has had a massive revenue growth and a great fourth quarter with its stock rocketing up in the recent weeks. Let's hope they can keep it up. Going off this week's market evaluations, we will go right into my article on the record high of the S&P 500 and the problems with valuations. The S&P closed with a record high this past week in the financial markets, and this posed the question whether stocks are overvalued. Experts told Yahoo Finance this wasn't the case. Drew Petit from Citi US Equity said, "When we look at the relationship between the markets, multiple and forward returns, it's non-existent. The current PE or price to earnings ratio is about 22%. This lies within the 92nd percentile of the S&P average value over the past 20 years. Brian Belsky from BMO prefers not to make these valuations because they are quote unquote a trap. He believes that these valuations experts make are the worst ways to measure future performance for a market. The main reason for this massive growth is because of these tech companies in the market like Apple, Amazon, and Tesla. These are all valued higher than the S&P. The Citi team actually tried to help the valuation problem by creating a metric that compared the company stock 10 years ago versus 20 years ago. When using this method, the S&P is closer to 19%, putting it in the 78th percentile, in line with the ranges made nearer to 2016. Petit states that the S&P 500 is, and I quote, not as expensive as it looks, but it doesn't mean it's cheap. With this also comes the interpretation that earnings will not be slowing down anytime soon.
I just have one question for you, Liam. What are some alternative methods for evaluating market valuations, aside from traditional metrics like the price-to-earnings ratio? And how do these methods provide a clear perspective on the current state of the market?
Thank you for your question, Alex. I think a great alternative is the PCF method, or price-to-cash flows method. This is good because the method doesn't incorporate non-cash expense items like depreciation or amortization. Special thanks to Josh Schaefer from Yahoo Finance for providing this article named "With the S&P 500 at a Record High, Strategies Warned Against Valuations, Trap." Always happy to hear about strategies within the investment world.
Now transitioning into a New York Times article showcasing Tesla drivers experiencing winter challenges in Chicago. Recently, in the face of brutal cold, Tesla batteries struggled, leaving many drivers stranded and questioning the reliability of electric vehicles in extreme weather. "It's kind of like I don't really want a Tesla," says Nick Sethi, a 35-year-old engineer in Chicago, who also said to have found his Tesla frozen shut. He spent an hour in -5-degree temperatures struggling with the locks. Another example, with Miss Rivera's car, which in normal conditions can drive up to 273 miles on a single 30-minute charge. This week, Miss Rivera said she awakened to find about a third of her car battery drained from the overnight cold. As temperature plummeted, she spent hours every morning waiting in line and recharging the battery. Some of the causes due to this is vehicles use more energy to heat their batteries in cabin in cold weather, so it's normal to see energy consumption increase. But for me, as someone passionate about the future of sustainable transport, this raises significant concerns. How will Tesla and other EV manufacturers adapt to ensure performances in all climates with the implications of this incident on Tesla's brand and the broader EV market? Now transitioning to Norway, some of the coldest countries with highest usage of electric vehicles are also among the coldest. In Norway, where nearly one in four vehicles is electric, Drivers are accustomed to taking steps such as preheating the car ahead of a drive to increase efficiency even in cold weather, said Lars Godbolt, an advisor of the Norwegian Electric Vehicle Association, which represents more than 120,000 electric car owners in Norway. Now, to wrap it up on a financial quantitative analysis, considering the potential impact of these weather-related challenges on Tesla's financial performance and investor sentiment, issues like these can influence customer confidence in electric vehicles and potentially affecting Tesla's sales and market share overall.
Great article, Shadi. I just have one question. With the batteries being so poor in Teslas, how can the industry address these issues to enhance the reliability of EVs and address climate in the long run, with electric vehicles becoming more and more popular in the future?
Yeah, that's a good question. Tesla was aware of this issue and actually addressed it publicly, reminding users in a post on its website where it offers a few tips for drivers. One of them was keep the charge level above 20% to reduce the impact of freezing temperatures. And also Tesla recommends that drivers use its scheduled departure feature, which registers a start of a trip in advance so the vehicle can determine the best time to start charging and preconditioning. What this does is allows the car to operate at peak efficiency from the moment it starts. Now, to answer your question, in the long run, for Tesla to discuss the cost implications for them in terms of research and development, because that is pivotal in improving battery technology for colder climate.
Thank you, Shadi, for your valuable information on Tesla. This week, I'm discussing a recent trend highlighting the power of disconnecting from the stock market and letting the market run. In a world constantly bombarded by financial news and market fluctuations, stepping back and disengaging from the daily noise can offer valuable insights and clarity. In a recent article by Jason Zweig for the Wall Street Journal, titled "What I Learned When I Stopped Watching the Stock Market," he shares his experience of taking a break from monitoring market activity and the lessons he gained from it. Zweig begins by likening his hiatus to that of Rip Van Winkle, who woke up to a transformed yet familiar world after a long slumber. His time away allowed him to observe investing ideas from a broader historical and psychological perspective, free from the temptation to act on short-term forecasts. Despite the market's fluctuations during his absence, including a significant downturn followed by a rapid recovery, Zweig remained blissfully unaware, highlighting the insignificance of daily market noise in the long run. He emphasizes the folly of trying to predict market movements, noting the inaccuracies of forecasts and the unpredictability of events such as geopolitical tensions affecting oil prices. Zweig's experience underscores the importance of focusing on long-term investment strategies rather than reacting impulsively to short-term fluctuations driven by new headlines. To combat the urge to overreact to market news, Zweig suggests a technique called mental time travel, where investors envision how they will feel about their decisions in the future. One effective method is writing letters to both their present and future selves, outlining their investment decisions, rationale, and anticipated outcomes. By imagining the consequences of their actions from a future perspective, investors can make more deliberate and rational choices, mitigating the risk of regret and anxiety caused by impulsive decisions. Zweig advocates for the adoption of this approach by both individual investors and financial advisors to foster informed decision-making and long-term financial well-being. By disconnecting from the daily market chatter and embracing a more measured approach to investing, individuals can navigate market volatility with clarity and confidence. In conclusion, Zweig's article highlights the value of taking a step back from a relentless stream of market news and adopting a more reflective and deliberate approach to investing. By focusing on long-term goals and avoiding the trap of reacting impulsively to short-term fluctuations, investors can cultivate a more resilient and sustainable investment strategy.
Great article, Alex. I'm just wondering one thing. Since your article discusses disconnecting from the stock market, why do you personally think that this is a smart option for investors?
Thanks, Liam. I think that mentally disconnecting from the stock market is smart for all investors because this helps to refrain from taking your money out and potentially losing out on gains from the markets. Since in the long run, the stock market trends upward, mentally disconnecting while the market is down is a very smart option for your future and for your finances.
Yeah, just to add on to that, in my opinion, if this ideology or idea is spread, I think a lot of people will apply it because not only is it smarter, but it's less work for them in the long run as they can just let the market run.
I appreciate that, Shadi. I like that take. And special thanks to Jason Zweig and the Wall Street Journal for the valuable information on mentality and in investing.
And with that, we conclude the fifth episode of our fourth season. A huge thank you to all of you for tuning in. Keep an eye out for your fellow Spartans. Again, Happy New Year, and as always, go green.
you enjoyed the discussion, please like and share the podcast on Apple and Spotify. The Spartan Journal podcast is part of Michigan State University's Wealth Management Association, a student organization whose goal is to inspire the next generation of financial advisors. The Spartan Journal news team releases a newsletter every Monday morning comprised of financial literacy and the week's market updates. Feel free to follow us on social media at MSUWMA and check out our website at msuwma.com. Anything heard on either the MSUWMA or Spartan Journal podcasts is for educational purposes only and should not be considered as investment advice.